That was a really master's performance, kept in front of us as perspective, which they have achieved and proven to the world as such. In my opinion, India, one of the leading BRIC country, we have ample scope as structural engineers, design, build people and producers of prime producers of steel to make a rapid engineering development which will have least life costs. You can say, you know, total life costing of a building, you say, if you have steel concrete combination, it will have a very low life cycle cost. And the sky is the limit. Mr. Sarvanand has given us a great perspective. And I would say we had a great pleasure of listening to him today. I would request everyone to give him a big hand right now again, please. I take special pride in introducing another star performance of our country, one of the professional structural engineer, Mr. Srinidhi, who is CEO of a well-built, well-architectured company by he himself. Name of the his company is Geodesic Technics. Another star performer in India as well as abroad, especially in the Middle East and maybe where all these companies will go. Mr. Srinidhi, I would say at the onset that he is a star performance of building airports in last just 3 to 4 years, three or four years time. And I will not stand in between him and you to appreciate his show. He is an engineer from Warangal Institute, REC Warangal, and Masters from Sydney in Design and Construction, Sydney University, Australia. And he has made his own life by his own mind and practice. Over to Mr. Srinidhi, of CEO of Geodesic Technics.
At least come up to some level there in the kind of works which we have done. I'm Srinidhi Ananthanaman. Just a little bit of additional background. I started this company in 1986, and in the beginning it was more a steel and glass kind of company. We were back in 86, you know, there were not many opportunities, so we were looking at steel and glass as our forte. Mainly we used to do a lot of geodesic domes and things like that, but as we evolved we realized that steel is one of the kind of mainstays, and some of the works, whatever the pictures you see in front, is all done by us. I'll just try to share with you what it is we represent. We are proud to call ourselves a company which makes engineered buildings. I know there is a kind of common terminology called pre-engineered buildings, but we use the word engineered buildings in a slightly different way. There is a lot of engineering that goes into the kind of buildings that we do. And we also do signature structures. And many of the examples we have done combines both engineered buildings and signature structures. Today's presentation will be more on airport roofing, because that's been the kind of, you can say, the trend in the last 3-4 years. We have had opportunity to do the Delhi airport, the Kolkata, the Mumbai, Indore, Raipur, Rajahmundry and Bangalore airport. Bangalore is the most recent one. So We'll just talk about these projects, and if there is time, I will talk about some of the other jobs we have done. This is, of course, the Bangalore Airport. If any of you people have recently gone there, you would see that originally Bangalore Airport was a very, very boring kind of industrial-looking structure, and this was the kind of complaint, though it was commissioned quite recently, about 5-6 years ago. It was a more of a 20th century kind of technology, you know, shell roof and all that. But when GVK took over the company, they wanted a more flamboyant looking kind of structure, and this was the outcome. This was designed by HOK, and in this our role was basically to do the steel structure. It was a design and build. That means the structural engineering, the connection design, the detailing, and the fabrication and erection was in our scope. This is Bangalore Airport is extended on 4 sides. On the north side, that is the air side, is a very small canopy that has been added, north canopy. On the west, it's a fairly largish kind of extension, it's 176 meters by 100 meters. A similar dimension on the east, though it is not exactly symmetrical structurally. On the south, there is a contribution to this was developing an unique node connector. These node connectors are an interesting thing. Actually, back in the early 90s, I had a few patents for node connectors because I used to sort of get a kick out of it. And I also used to use these node connectors to make space frame kind of structure. After a very long hiatus, actually, we got back to developing a node connector. I'll just show you an image of that a little later. And what we really did was, though it was a freeform geometry, we standardized it in such a way that nobody at the manufacturing plant really felt it was dissimilar items. Just to tell you, every truss, every member, everything that went into it is unique. It had a drawing of its own. There was no two components which were similar. In spite of that, it was done in a highly automated fashion. Okay? And of course, the tree columns themselves were architectural and things like that. These are some of the images during the construction. So you get a kind of idea of what kind of shapes that we are dealing with. What we did was, in plan, there's an 8 meter by 8 meter grid. And at each of the intersection of these grids, we introduced node. And because the truss is 2 layers, the node continued from the top layer to the bottom layer. That is what we developed here. I think I have an image here. So yeah, this is the special node connector we developed. And these are at the junctions of the trusses. The top chord of the truss comes and meets here, bottom chord of the truss comes and meets here. You see some images here. These nodes were bigger or smaller depending on the kind of forces and other issues. But primarily, they always were a standardized kind of system. The truss themselves had varying elevations on the left-hand side and the right-hand side, or the jth node, kth node, or whatever you may call it. The elevations differed. But as far as the fabrication was concerned, we had set up a kind of, a slightly more flexible kind of fixture, so that at the fabrication shop, nobody really had any major difficulty. There was one interesting problem that came up there. Because the structure was connected to the existing building, there was some issue that turned out that the existing building could not take any additional lateral force. So what happened, even PTFE roller support and things like that, that also has a certain small amount of horizontal forces coming into it. Even that, you know, they wanted us to eliminate. So we came up with what we call this double knuckle kind of system. This is a unique system. We developed it here. So this acts as a true roller, and it completely eliminates all the horizontal forces coming onto the main structure. These are the two main things you can say. Of course, the third thing was this tree column kind of thing. This had a fair amount of architectural involvement. The French architect was very, very particular how it should be enabled and stuff like that. This is just some more images of it. Here, there's nothing else which is really extraordinary because erection was fairly straightforward. Once the structures were fabricated, there was no real issues in terms of assembling it or putting it together, except that there were some tolerance issues at the interconnection point with the existing building. Okay, this is another interesting job which we had done. This we did it about, I think in 2008, 2009. We completed the job in 2009. Here we did actually the passenger terminal building, that the center portion. This was about 22 acres of roof. And here, as you see, whenever you encounter an airport roof, one of the big problems you have is the departure level slab. both on the air side and the land side. They are fairly large slabs. I'm not talking about the piers. Piers are quite easy to do. The main, you know, the processor building or the passenger terminal building or something, there you can't run cranes on the slab. So what happens, you have to come up with interesting techniques for actually erecting it. This again was a design and build job. This also was HOK. I forgot to mention, even the Bangalore airport is, the architecture is by HOK. This also by HOK. This again was a design and build. We did the actual structural engineering, connection design, and fabrication, you know, detailing, shop drawing, and erection. Here the system which we developed was, we assembled these large trusses at the departure level slab. This I'm talking about the land side. And we actually, we assembled them in 1 acre and 1.5 acre segments. We lifted them into position using this multi, 12-point synchronized lifting and 16-point synchronized lifting. What happened, the advantage was that we were able to sort of do much of the work at the ground level, lift it up, tilt it, take it up to the top, you see this thing, shift it laterally and lower it back on the column. So that is how this is, there are some more images of this thing, how the roof truss was being lifted. The 1 acre segment was about 415 tons. The 1.5 acre segments, the 16-point lift was about 650 tons. On the land side, this was on the land side. On the air side, we had other issues. We had a lot of obstructing structures at the departure level slab. So there we had to come up with another system where we actually pulled it into position. We assembled it at the bullnose point at the full level and we pulled it into position, again in very large segments. I have a video of this, it may not be too long. I will also try to skip it from time to time. See how this actual lift was being done. I'll just skip it a little bit. This is the control of the 12-point and 16-point synchronized lifting. Here you see the actual truss being lifted up. It goes up to 6 meter level and then we do the tilt. The roof tilt is done there. And this is a fairly simple system. You know, mostly when you're doing erection and temporary work designs and stuff like that, it's not like statistical loading. You are actually encountering the loading. In fact, the next airport job, you'll realize what we're talking about. So we actually took the strand jacks, shifted it laterally. You know, we made it horizontal and we pulled it into position. I think this is the last bit of the thing. And this geometrically is a little tricky. This structure itself is a little tricky. Yeah, see, it was just lowered and lowered onto the column. I was telling you about the air side. You see, all these things were coming in the way. So what we did was we put a complete scaffold system and we had this, stainless steel, tracks. And we had PTFE rollers underneath the structure. We kept assembling at the bullnose and we kept pulling it inwards. And finally, again, see, this is a video of it. The last segment we were pulling about 650 tons. Of course, obviously, pulling is much easier than lifting. And this was quite an interesting structure. Again, this was done in large segments. This, obviously, this side, this air side, pulling is a little more expensive because of the temp works involved. Again, it gives just an idea of the kind of scale that we were dealing with. Let me see if I can just skip forward. Yeah, this is the final segment, I think, or maybe the pre-final segment. We would pull it to a certain extent and then assemble one more 12-meter sections, you know. This was totally about 22 acres of roof. Yeah, I think this is the completion. Okay. This actually is something which we are very proud of. This is an interesting job. Many of you people may not have actually seen it because it's not yet commissioned. But this is a very interesting project because actually it's Terminal 2. We came departure level slab. So we came up with a complete system, a highway truss kind of system, on which these pods were rolled into position. The erection system was very, very interesting. Then Discovery Channel happened to come onto it and they made a sort of interesting feature about this particular work also. And this is about 33 acres of roof, very large cantilevers. And though it says cantilevers 70 meters, there are some cantilevers which are close to 40 meters. But they are suspended between the pods actually, between the mega columns. This also has mega columns which weigh about 60 tons odd. That is only a shorter segment of the mega column, which is about 16 meters long. I'll just show you that in an image. This is roughly the kind of layout. This is the processor building, what they call passenger terminal building. Here the piers are integrated in some way. These are the kind of piers. And there is one large kind of roof also here where there's a lot of the shopping and things like that happens there. And there is 3A. This is also not completed because there is a huge slum here. This is the portion which we did. There was another portion which was done earlier by Eversendai. This is the final, you know, kind of a model what we had developed in the structure. Each of this is a pod. You can see that there are totally 30 pods, out of which 28 are of one type. Only these two are a slightly different kind of pod. They are a flat pod. All the other pods are in a different shape, which you will get to know a little earlier. What we did was we developed a, obviously erection was a big problem. We had about half an acre of space here. We set up the tower here. We did the entire assembly at this point, and we built a whole highway truss system attached to it. So this was the sequence in which the particular work was done. If you ask me what is this big gaping hole here, this gaping hole is actually a gaping hole in my bank balance, but more importantly, it was a gaping hole kept for Shivaji statue, because Shivaji statue could not be moved there. If you guys remember, there was a huge Shivaji statue there, which was supposed to be moved in 3 months. It took 18 months to move. So it was a very big constraint on this particular project. Anyway, we suffered that, but this job was actually done in spite of that. This is the final configuration. This is some snippets from the Discovery Channel, because they have interconnecting the columns. This is our video. This is a little bit clearer. This also shows the overall view. This is how grand your Bombay airport is going to be. It is really very, very interesting. Again, the size of the pod you will get from the size of the people who are working there. That is just one node, actually. And it was, in some ways, we have our own reservations that design-wise, it could have been simplified. We felt that there was an opportunity to actually make it simpler. I won't say lighter, but simpler, and hence more economical. But we didn't get that opportunity to do any value engineering there. But this is the actual movement taking place during the erection process. But this was something of great learning for us, and I feel that this is a job which we will always be proud of. Eventually, when you people see it also, it's a very, very interesting project. It's something even India needs to be proud of. It's a large airport in very, very confined conditions. So these are just some snapshots of the picture itself. There are some more images only. Okay. Again, similar kind of thing. These pods were, you know, were trial fitted in our factory, so that there was no issues at the site. These pods, you can get it, it's much taller than the factory building itself. This height from here to here is 16 meters. So obviously we couldn't assemble it inside, but we did the thing outside. This was the mega column. The earlier mega column was done by Eversendai up to that springing level. The last segment of the mega column was done by us. Okay. This is the Delhi International Airport. This I will just skip through a little faster. This was done about 4-5 years ago. Many of you might have actually flown in and out of this airport. This steel structure was done by us. It was quite interesting. Hafiz contractor was the architect. It's quite nice. I think the true value we added was basically doing a fairly slender. Might have flown in and out of. This is the Kingfisher Terminal, they used to call it. Now I don't know what they'll refer to it as. This is the not Terminal 1B, the other side, the on the air side, where generally all the aircrafts nowadays land and take off from. This was done by us. This is again the curved double beam. This is during construction. Here there were some very interesting challenges, particularly in terms of fire protection, because there was a huge demand for architecturally rendered kind of fire protection. And that was something we went through a process. And it had also these pencil columns, which are the tapering kind of columns, nicely at the end of the day. This is the other job, Kolkata Airport. This again is a good example of a job, very well detailed and fabricated. This, of course, again is not yet inaugurated. This is a very nice job. It's an indoor airport. This again was beautifully designed by the architect, and we were able to achieve it at Rajahmundry Airport. This, I'm not too sure it is anything good looking or anything, because it has got space frames which are too dense and all these kind of things. But these are situations where architects sometimes do not realize how space frames, if it is not properly used, can be a little too busy, you know, too much of a jungly kind of look it can come. But still, as a job, it was an interesting job. Okay. Just a little of an Indian company, out and out Indian company. We have no collaboration, nothing of that kind. It's all whatever you see in front of you is developed by us, probably reinvented many times also. The three areas which we really claim to profess is what we call architectural engineering, structural engineering, and construction engineering. How we sort of define architectural engineering is more to do with style, detail, and sustainability. But detail is the most important, though it's the middle point, the most important thing. Structural engineering, everybody knows. I mean, strength, stability, serviceability kind of stuff. Construction engineering is more to do with the time, cost, and constructability, most importantly. This is something which we say is what we bring to the table as a value add for a project. And we use a fairly large set of affiliates. We have, in fact, we were one of the first companies to actually use a robo in India. This was about 7-8 years ago. Just very briefly, what are the kind of lessons, at least I have learned over my 20-25 years? Form always defines or drives the structural behavior and function. You need to pay a lot of attention to form. If you don't pay attention to form, invariably you're going to go hit some kind of a dead end somewhere. This is a personal kind of philosophy I follow. If you are able to define a problem properly, the solutions are there inside it. They will emerge. They are embedded. But the tricky thing is not to find solutions. Tricky thing is to define the problem. If you define the problem in the wrong way, you will never get solution. But if you define it in the right way, solutions exist inside it. This is another thing which I personally follow and my company also follows. First principles are the best principles. Try as much as possible to go back to first principles. How much ever you may have thought that you have evolved and this and that, and you can, but you can, because you can make mistakes. What applied one time may not apply again. So it's good to go back to first principles. The next one is code books. They are generally for the guidance of wise men. There is an old saying which says that code books are for the guidance of wise men and the obedience of fools. So this is more important, more than anything else is important in our country today, because we tend to become a little superstitious about code books. It is not superstition, it's not a Veda, it is not some kind of utterances or a decree by somebody. It is meant as a guidance for you to understand. If you find a code book doesn't permit something, you need to dig deeper, find out why the code book says something like that. What is the background behind it? Can we overcome it in some other way? So this is something I tell my engineers and I tell everybody I meet also about this. So this leads to that point of experience can sometimes lead to superstition. So you have to be a little bit careful. Too much of experience sometimes is a little dangerous. One point which I want to talk about, all the works which you have seen in our case is about balancing strength and slenderness. See, to make it strong is easy. To make it strong and slender is not easy. That is a little harder. So that is a key actually in terms of architectural engineering and in terms of modern engineering, where you're talking about sustainability and life cycle costing or whatever you may call it. Okay, this leads to my final thing. Engineering is not the monopoly of engineers. I know it's a very fine institution where I am saying this, but I believe just the same way architecture is not the monopoly of architects, similarly engineering is not the monopoly of engineers. There are non-engineers also who can contribute equally well to engineering. Sir, how am I doing on time? Okay, yeah. So what I thought was, I have some more works which I'll just quickly skim through just to show you a kind of sampling of the kind of works which we have done when I mentioned initially about glass and steel. This is one job which many of you people might have seen. This is in Mumbai. This is in Mumbai. This is near Bangalore. This is again in Mumbai. This is in Mumbai. This is in Delhi. These are all steel and glass structures, freeform structures, large actually. This is the MMRDA office building. It's a 16-story building. And what is the interesting thing is got about 28-meter spanning, floor spans. These three floors and these three floors, the floor spans are column-free. They span 28 meters. Otherwise, it's a fairly straightforward building. What happened initially was they had called us only for making the beams, those beams. And we told them that it might be better to bury some composite steel inside it so that at least we can finish the work. We finished this work in 3.5-4 months. Then, of course, the concrete encasement all took another 1-1.5 years. This is a very interesting job which we have done. It's a pure steel building. It is a lead-rated building. If I'm not mistaken, it may be a platinum-rated building. Eicher Volvo headquarters in Delhi. It's an architectural building. So that is what it is. It's a low rise. It's not a very high rise kind of building, but it's quite an interesting structure in terms of thing. This one interesting job we did about 7-8 years ago. This is just a simple. This portion of the job was done very fast. The rear portion, there was some hard rock in that particular site. This was done for Infosys. What is interesting is this is one of in India the only known example of a post-tension steel building. This was a design and build by us. We were controlling deflections by using post-tensioning of steel, and we developed the entire hardware that goes into it. Unfortunately, we have not had another chance to do this, but this is very interesting technology by itself. This is another car park in Mumbai. This actually is a temporary car park, though it has got about 1,600 cars. This is at a location where the building 3A or something is going to come up. So the brief that was given to us was to build the building in such a way that it can be dismantled and re-erected after 3-4 years. So what we did was, in this case, we cast in situ the slabs. Steel, of course, is suitable for that, situ in the conventional sense of the word. This is some library buildings where, of course, the brief was, it's a turnkey job where we had to do the architecture, interiors, and the civil works and structure and everything. We have done our share of these kind of jobs. This is another job of a similar nature. In fact, we did this earlier, and after this, some minister came and saw it, and he was insisting that we do it for him in his college. So that's how the other job came about. This is another interesting job we have done for Infosys. This is 100 meters by 60 meters by 40 meters, and it's quite an enjoyable job, I think, in that sense. This is a very nice job this we have done in Chennai. This is quite a kind of, you can say, an international standard job. This is the TCS Techno Park. In fact, Everest and I are also doing one part of this job, which is the phase 3 part of the thing. We did the phase 1 and phase 2. This is 6 corporate software development blocks. On top of it, there's got this mini spines, it's got these wings, and there's one central spine. The central spine has got about 26 meters cantilever here, and similarly on the other end, it's tip to tip is 405 meters. This is another view of the structure. It's a very grand architectural sculpture, you can say. And this used about roughly about 8,000 or 8,500 tons of steel. And this is how we had visualized the mini spines. This is again a classical case where you needed a unique drawing for every component that went into it. And this is where we obtained the robo. This was back in 2006. We set up our own 7-axis robo. In fact, we wrote all the software for it to drive the profiling and everything. Much later, there are tools that is capable of doing it. But this was at the site. This was the site fabrication setup which we had. This was the erection methodology, the way it was being done for mini spine, the EB wings erection. We also did some architectural staircases. This how the architectural intent was, the way we had sort of drawn it, and the way it was achieved was here. This is the gardens by the bay I was talking to you about. This bit. So with this, I just would like to wrap up my presentation, and I'm sure there'll be an opportunity for some question answer later or something like that. But this is our, our experience of Indian projects, purely Indian projects made in India. Thank you very much. Steel metro stations or steel monorail stations, they are really the answer. I think somewhere along the line, we need a kind of mass movement which takes over. If you look at UK, 80% of the construction is in steel. Okay, China also, the steel kept increasing, but at the same time, because of the huge volume of construction that was going there, concrete also kept increasing. But at the end of the day, steel is, I'm not saying 80% should be steel, but there are certain projects which should be done in steel. In my view, Mumbai is ideally a candidate for steel for both your metro stations, your tall buildings, as well as your flyovers and things like that. They should all be in steel, because they're easier to build, they're less aggressive on the thing. Second thing, in terms of life cycle costing, because people are talking about that, I would like to just say that steel as a life cycle, economy, is far, far better than concrete. Concrete, as you're building concrete, you're building debris, because at the end of the day, you can only break it. Rare are the opportunities like that mile car park. Otherwise, you just have to break concrete, whereas steel doesn't have that. Steel can be cut up. Invariably, when you sell it as scrap at a later, after 20 years, it has a higher value than what you had spent. One other thing is, construction as a process is not being addressed enough. in terms of green buildings and all that. They take construction as a magical activity, and after that, they talk about greenness of the building and, you know, energy consumption. But if you look at the actual construction process, steel is very calm and very, you know, benign. I remember one job we did in Infosys. We did that multi-level car park. We had about 26 people on the site. Adjacent to that, there was an 11-story building being done. They had 650 people on the site. You can just compare. I rest my case. We had only 26 people, and mind you, in those days, I never had a factory. That included the site fabrication people also. Factory I started only 3 years ago, but before we always used to do site fabrication. So that's the real difference between steel and concrete. So, of course, steel and concrete are both, in my opinion, God's gift to mankind. The fact that, you know, they are, you know, RCC itself, if you look at, was the single biggest revolution of the 19th century. After that, what has happened? Now we are talking about compositing RCC with structural steel. There is a slight difference. We have to understand that difference, but there is a difference in the way it is used. But it was meant to be together. It was not dissimilar material. They were meant to be together. And true solution lies in, as you rightly put, compositing the whole thing with RCC and steel.